Abundant Life Church is like a family, people who are very welcoming.
I think what I've loved about Abundant Life is the words really push me and challenge me a lot.
Abundant Life Church means legacy to me.
To me, Abundant Life Church means community.
ALC is both a place and people. It's the place where I go to get the tools that I need to be more of me.
This light feeling came over me and I said, oh, okay, this is the church that I think I want to be in.
My favorite thing about ALC would be the family dynamic of it.
Getting back to the community, which I have been away from for a while, and getting back with my family.
I think of Abundant Life as home, with all the warm, fuzzy feelings that you feel about home.
The Abundant Life Church means to me abundant life. And what that means to me is a life full of God in everything.
I think it's just a place that welcomes me and doesn't separate me or puts me in a box.
Abundant Life means hearing God's voice.
It's a great place to grow and to learn and to really be connected with people.
It means growth to me. It has changed my life.
Some place where I can go and feel safe and loved and protected and guided.
Throughout the history of the Africans in the Americas, the church has long been a source for spiritual enrichment, scriptural understanding, and sacred expression. This foundational trinity is embodied in Christianity and has been at the heart of the Black church experience. While organized around spiritual principles, Black churches were faithfully relied upon to address the whole body experience of its members. Living out the mantra, lifting while climbing, churches were called upon to provide care for the sick, financial assistance for those in need, and a platform for community engagement and education. The Black church has always been at the nexus of both religion and home. And so it was 100 years ago when a small band of like-minded, spirit-led believers blessed a piece of land in Cambridge, Massachusetts, as the Apostolic Pentecostal Church, and began a work that has grown and continues today as one of the region's favored hush harbors.
When I came here in the early 40s, I was 24 years old when I came here. Bishop Rotten was the pastor when I first came here, and he was the founder of the church when I came here. So he baptized me and everything, and I became a member of the church. The people that I met when I came here was elderly people. We had a few young people, but not many. But most of them was elderly people, which they're dead now. But I enjoy them, and they enjoy me too.
Well, we'll start with the name. This church was the Pentecostal church, but
everybody related this church as the Darton Church. That's the way it was described. What church are you going to? Darton Church. And everybody knew where the Darton Church was. My grandfather, Conrad Darton, Bishop Conrad Darton, he was born in Barbados. And he came from Barbados to Canada. Mm-hmm. And from Canada, he came to United States. He started preaching, and he preached in the Corners here in Cambridge, the Parks. And it got to a point where he had so many followers that they went and had a small place. They went to small hotels, I guess it was. And so they finally found this church. And this church was a factory. It was an abandoned building. And some of his followers decided that they would have this church. They reconstructed it. And my grandfather was able to live upstairs. And that's where he got started.
When I got here, Brother Darton was still the pastor of the church, and this looked more like a two-family duplex than it did, or triplex, than it does a church today. Simeon Darton, who was actually the piano player for the church, used to come in and out of the church on a regular basis. So it was always very comical, because if we needed some music and nobody could play the hymn, they would ask someone to run up, knock on Brother Simeon's door, and have him come down and play the music for us for the Sunday service.
I had an opportunity to talk with the wife of the original founder, Bishop Conrad Darton, who had passed. And she gave me some insight that I don't think many people know, except maybe Pastor Ward and Pastor Aiden Ward, unless he passed it on to others. But the church then was a tremendous family church, because there were Dottons, I guess, all over the place. And it got to the point where it was called Darton's Church. And he, I believe, was instrumental in leading this church to unite with the other Cambridge churches, some of the other Cambridge churches, to form the United Pentecostal Council. And I think that was also centered around the fact that there were missionaries that they'd sent to Africa, Liberia, I believe.
When I talk about Cambridge, I talk about Cambridge with my head high. Not because, you know, I'm the great-granddaughter of the person who founded this church, but because I believe that. I believe the stories that were told to me and passed down to me about Bishop Conrad and Darton, and how when he used to walk down the street, the people used to take their hats off, and you're out of reverence and respect for who he was, and I believe for others also in spiritual leadership in the city.
The word foundation, a basis upon which something stands or is supported, is found in 61 different Bible verses. Apostolic Pentecostal Church took this word and wove it into the very fabric of its mission.
Oh, absolutely. It's like to this day, wherever I am, I will mention that I remember my beginnings, and my beginnings was right here, the Apostolic Pentecostal Church. that's what it was called then, you know, and it really did mold me, you know, and give me what I call my foundation, which I am very pleased today for, you know, because I couldn't see living a life without God.
We had such great relationships with the elder people. We listened to what they said, they taught us well, and they sort of held us accountable. And accountability is key in religion, as everyone knows. If you're not doing the right thing, somebody needs to call you out on it. And you need to correct it. There's so many different ways that, you know, you can look at the foundation that was prepared for us when we were kids.
This is where I started. This is where I went to Sunday school from a child. This is where I was baptized. The Sunday school brought in many people who later became members of the church, but it just brought in a lot of people who didn't become members, but appreciated what Apostolic Pentecostal had to offer back then, and would think of it as their church, although they didn't, you know, formally join the church or anything. We also had a picnic every 4th of July. And I remember staying in my window and just waiting for the buses to come. You know, you had everything already. Your sneakers were polished, and you know, it was just wonderful waiting for that bus to come so that we could go on a Sunday school picnic. And many of the other churches around, our sister churches too, would join us wherever we went for the Sunday school picnic. And I guess I just liked the love and feeling of family that existed among the congregation. You know, you were everyone's child, you know. And with good intentions, they were there to make sure or to help you in your walk with Christ, you know. And so... And because it was more community-based, you know, I mean, you would be out in the street and you would hear, well, I don't think you should be doing that. but in a nice, loving way.
On Easter Sundays, your prime objective was to get an Easter outfit, which the kids don't do today. And we get suits and ties, we get up onto the platform and say our recitations to our family. Everybody would clap, or if you didn't get clapped at, you were ashamed. Your family would talk about you for days because, you know, you didn't meet the mark.
I began with this church as a baby, I guess. I only can remember this church as a little girl. And my grandparents used to live right next door at 37 Howard Street. We would come here, of course, for morning service, and then it was our Sunday school. Then we went to my grandmother's house. We would eat and everything. We'd come back for evening service. So, and then we were here all week long. On Mondays, we would come here for prayer service. It was prayer service and tarry service. They don't have tarry services anymore. In those days, the elders, the ministers thought that you had to go to the altar and pray until the you spoke in tongues. For me, it was just normal because that's what I was used to, because that's how my mother lived. My mother was really, really, really Christian. And that's all she did, was just come to church. As a young teenager, when we were here and we would have prayer meeting and everyone would be down on their knees praying, I would sneak out the church and go right across the street to the Cambridge Community Center and get back before they got off their knees.
It was good, long days. I would come here in the morning, and sometimes you didn't get through the afternoon and had to come back later on at night, you know, and Sunday school in the morning. And sometimes I didn't want to go to Sunday school. And I told my mother I was not feeling good when I was feeling all right. And so when church was over and my mother came home, I thought that I could take my bicycle and meet my friends and ride around. And I was told by my mother and father that if you can't go to church, you're not riding your bicycle. I can remember, matter of fact, where I'm sitting right now. It used to be hot in the summertime, and naturally they had the windows open in Sunday school. And some of my friends would know, they know I'm here, and they would talk loud, and I could hear them. And I knew where they were going. They were going down to Revere Beach, and they knew I couldn't come. And that used to bother me. I used to say to my mother and father, how come they can go down to Revere Beach and I can't? Well, the mother and father should let them come to church, and you wouldn't have to worry about them.
I am here for my mother, which was Mariel Cox. She is now deceased, and I will be speaking for her. We had a group. She formed a young people's group. It consisted of, I think it was about five or six young women at that time. There weren't too many young men in that area, in that era, coming to the church. But she did form this group with Sister Blackman. At that time, she was the young people's president. And we would go with her wherever she preached, and we would sing. So my mother wasn't a person that really could sing, but she she would try, and along with Brother Simeon Dotton, he would come to our house, and he would say, Mariel, I have a song here. I want the girls to sing. And of course, I could sing, thank God. I could sing. The Lord blessed me with a voice, and they would put me to stand there and sing, and then we would bring it to the group. And we traveled various places singing. So she worked. She was in charge of the group. And although she couldn't sing, she was right there. Let's do this. Let's do that. Let's do this. Okay, go over this part again. She loved music. Loved music.
After 35 years of unwavering faithfulness, the passing of the church's founder, Bishop Conrad Dotton, led to a succession of pastors: Reverend Theophilus Waldron, Reverend Archibald Hassel, and Deacon Rufus Marshall, who, in the spirit of Proverbs 22:6, all continued to lead Apostolic Pentecostal Church in the way it should go. The thread would continue in 1966 when Reverend Aidan Ward was installed as pastor.
We're going to speak to you this morning on contending for the faith that was once delivered to the saints. Now we realize that going into the 20th century, many men are predicting that the end of the world will come in the year 2000. But the Bible tells us in the 24th chapter of Matthew that no man know the end, and the gospel of Jesus Christ must be preached in all the world before the end.
When I came to pastoring, it was kind of hard because they weren't used to having a young pastor, and they were used to Bishop Dotton, the older man. And after Bishop Dotton died, then we had Elder Waldron, and Elder Waldron only lasts 5 years. And then we had Elder Hassel, and he lasts 5 years. So then it was Deacon Marshall and I worked together. He couldn't preach, so I had to do the preaching.
I would say Abundant Life Church means home to me. And the reason why I say that is that
My relationship started with Abundant Life Church way back in Barbados. I was 7 years old when I met Pastor Emeritus. Always loved young people. Whenever he came to Barbados, he would always try to scope out the young people, those that he see all engaging in the worship. He loved worship.
Well, first of all, we were known as the Waith Sisters. Only thing I remember is we lived on the left side upstairs above the church. And when they had church services, you know, morning, noon, and night. So we rocked to the music. We rocked ourselves asleep to the music. Pastor Emeritus, Aiden Ward, he was our pastor.
His wife, Gwendolyn Ward. So they were both good team players. One would never seen one without the other. So Mom Ward was very quiet. Pastor E was a little more resourceful, keep you hopping. but good people.
Yeah.
Loved us as like their own kids.
I came from Barbados 1 year in 1987. And I was just living around the corner and I saw this church and I take a peep in. And I decided to come in and try it, coming from home, from a Pentecostal church. Mm-hmm. And I liked it. It was only like 4 weeks, I think, I spent here in this country. And I used to come in and like visit and, you know, and I felt warmth. I felt love. I felt comfortable, just like home. It reminded me of the church back home to preach the word, as the word of God said, in season over season, and I enjoyed it. I get so comfortable, and I said to the pastor, Pastor Aiden, I want to be a member of the church. He did not reject me. He accepted me, you know, and so on and so on. And Sister Ward, which was his wife, Gwendolyn Ward, she was such a sweet woman, and she was like a seer in the church.
While Pastor Ward had the responsibility of guiding souls to Christ, he also had some very definite ideas on how the saints should look on the journey.
He was very strict in regard to that. He prided himself in how we all look like himself, how he carries his own self, well-dressed, shine shoes, head to toe.
The dress code, I think the older saints were dressing different anyway, you know, coming from the Caribbean, but I think we still know that we come into the temple of the gods, so we have to dress accordingly.
Personally, I like people dressed up. That's me. I like people dressed up. I like people come in church with a suit on and shoes clean and whatnot. I like that because that's the way I am. But my wife used to tell me, everybody is not you. So you got to leave people alone. We don't preach against clothes. So we let people wear what they have. And they come to church. What we need is the presence of God. More than anything else, having God in our midst as we meet on Sunday mornings.
It was good to people, no, it was no problem. It was good to people, but it was strict. He wanted things to be done, they were supposed to be done, and he will preach for 1 hour, and he will drop when he's preaching, and he's giving some joke when he's preaching, and people laughing, and it was good, though.
Great, I enjoy his, he was a great, in fact, he baptized me. He was great preacher.
And
yeah.
Me, baptized and me
too. Both of us, yeah.
He had that powerful,
loud voice, yes.
Glory!
Yeah, and well, like for a while, I think it was like in the latter part of 1980, I told the pastor I had a dream that, you know, I wasn't being fed enough like that. So I explained the dream to him and stuff. So he said, Sister Mary, I said, yes. He said, you know what? I said, no. He said, you're not putting anything into the church. That's why you're not getting anything out of church. So that's when I started clapping my hand and I opened my mouth praising the Lord and stuff like that. So that's what got me started praising the Lord. And he said, you got to put something in church to take something out of it.
He was excellent as a pastor. Like I said, he was very strict and stern. He didn't believe in any foolishness, but he was a people person. And one of the things I liked about him, and I always, up to today, I see it, he was a person that reached out into the community and cared about people, and he could preach. He was a little, I call a little fireball man, you know. He used to get wired up in the church, and he could preach, and he also could teach very well.
I used to teach Sunday school, and of course, the office got too small because the adults that I had in the class would tell people about me, and they would come to hear the gospel. And a lot of them really enjoyed it. And the room was really packed at times to hear me teach the Sunday school. And I was the pastor at the same time. The real highlights of my ministry was when I had revivals. And they brought crowds in from different churches. They were closed. And they would come to Howard Street to hear the evangelist, ever who he or she was. And that was a real happy time for me in my ministry.
I was always struck by his appearance. He just has such a formidable presence, even if he didn't say anything. And you just got the sense that he did the nurturing and the hand-holding and the fundraising and the spirit-raising. He did all of that, but always with this sort of wonderful dignity. And I don't think anybody's ever heard him raise his voice or say a cross word. It just didn't seem like it could ever come. Now, he could probably give a look that would give you some pause.
I liked his preaching style, you know. You know, he had a way when he gave a message, there was always something that I felt I could leave with that I learned. You know, it was definitely based on the Word of God, which, you know, was very important. And like I said, back then, you're being a child and a teenager, you don't realize it, but it's what became my food for later in life.
As a child, they didn't have a worship team. They had, my mom played the piano and then the organ, because we didn't always have an organ. We had a piano and she would play the piano. And members who had instruments would just show up with them and they would play. And it sounds like it was some kind of crazy mass confusion, but it wasn't. They had hymnals. And so there was a hymnal for day for morning service, and there was a hymnal for the evening service. So we had different, and people would call out the number for the song that they wanted to sing. And sounds chaotic, but it wasn't as chaotic as one would really think something like that would be. I remember one time going to a church where they had the hymns that were going to be sung on a board, and I thought that that was an interesting concept. That wasn't what was happening here.
He sang from hymn books, and people had their favorite numbers, favorite hymns. And that, again, was something people would call out. And so when you were singing, someone would say 35, and somebody else would be saying 50, and so whichever one was, you know, pushed for his or her song, that's the song you sang. People were joyful. That was, and it was a joy that stayed with them. When you went to homes, you'd find them singing and playing gospel music. They were really involved in worshiping God, and that was an important piece of their lives.
I can remember coming with my grandmother, Eunice Dodden, and I can't tell you how old I was. I was little, I know that. But I always remember hearing the music from down the street. And as we were coming in, it would always excite me to get here. But this is the place where I learned the hymns. I think it was like, honoring mothers on this day, honoring mothers on this day, bringing flowers, love, and joy in every way,
honoring mothers on this day.
That rich history, the music, the preaching, the walk of faith, and all the ingredients that were used to build up God's people at Apostolic Pentecostal were put to the test on a winter morning in 1974.
Who would burn the church and why?
It was really a terrible time when we had the fire.
We found out about the fire around, it must be 4 o'clock in the morning, some early hour. Our phone rang and someone called my dad and told him the church was on fire. Well, that left. We were like, are you kidding? The church is on fire? How could that be? But my dad continued to get dressed and the phone keeps ringing. My mom's answering the phone. My father's trying to get out the house. And we just kind of like stayed out of everybody's way.
I actually lived right down the street. So we could see the fire and the fire engines and things. It was disastrous. I mean, we just couldn't believe that our church was on fire. But the people rallied together, as heartbreaking as it was. And we had a lot of help from neighbors who didn't particularly go to the church, but the church meant something to the community. And so we had a lot of community support, along with the support of, you know, the members and stuff. And we gladly went into rebuilding.
When we first heard of the fire, because I was working then at the post office in Central Square. And when the pastor called me and told me, we all were, in fact, the pastor was crying, of course, and we all felt it, you know. But then things were worked out, and as you said, it were not so bad after all, yeah, because we were able to get the things that we didn't have before. So I thought to me, and we all did, you know, it was a blessing to us.
The people was upset when they heard the building was on fire. But they said, we're going to rebuild. And so they had the money, and we rebuilt the church and became like it is now. Only thing, you could put up new lights. But we did a good job getting it fixed back together.
The whole fire issue was very devastating because it was in the midst of the remodeling, where we were trying to remodel the church, make it better, more conducive for ministry. So when something happens to destroy that, then my dad would persevere anyway. If he says something's happening, it's happening. So whatever happened in the middle, his faith is so strong in God that God told him to do this, that this was happening. So even with the fire, he proceeded to do the things that he needed to do so that the work could continue.
The work did continue. Apostolic Pentecostal Church not only transformed their building, but as the years passed and the church grew in import and impact, spiritual seeds that were planted long ago were now ready for harvest.
I wasn't effective as I used to be, and I said, when I get 70 years old, I'm going to give up because I want to see my successor before I die. I don't want to die and leave the church without a pastor.
One funny story.
Yeah.
Reverend Ward was retiring, and he came. A family had a funeral in Boston, but they wanted him to do the eulogy at this other church. And he was slowing down a little, and he was on his cane. And once he comes to the pulpit, once he grabs that mic, he becomes alive and stuff. and he had this fabulous eulogy. And afterwards, when he was leaving, a person in the church said, "Reverend, why are you retiring and stuff?" And his answer was, "What's the boy gonna do?"
So I said to my wife, I said, "I'm 70 years old. I'm not as effective as I used to be. I want Larry to be the pastor." And she said, "You want Larry to be?" I said, "Yes, I want him to be the pastor. And I hope that he wins the election."
And with that blessing and the prayerful consideration of the Apostolic Pentecostal faithful, Reverend Lawrence Ward was elected to succeed his father and was installed as pastor on Sunday, June 12, 1994.
In God's word, there is law. There is law. We're lawbreakers. We do not do the law of God. We cannot keep the law of God. So we're now in a position where, you know what? We have the right to experience the wrath of God. Now, here's what it is. Now, God is not waiting around to strike you with a lightning bolt. Glory be to God. Somebody say, thank you, Jesus.
It was certainly a concern because you're going from a 70-year-old man to a 32-year-old. And though I was raised in the church, mm-hmm. I think the concern was I old enough to minister to a group that was much older than me?
Right.
And these were Sunday school teachers. These were people who raised me, so to speak. When it comes to comparisons, mm-hmm. you have to think about that. And you have to think about what my father's role has been, and as he was a senior minister in Cambridge, all the relationships that he's developed over the years. I've watched and I've learned a lot from him because he was, you know, my mentor. Mm-hmm. And as we went through different stages of development in ministry, he was there to kind of coach me and train me. So I wasn't too concerned about my level of readiness mm-hmm. to accept the role as being pastor. But I was concerned about the people's readiness to kind of accept me as a pastor because I was so young in comparison to my dad, who was 70. I mean, 32 and 70, that's a great distance.
And there was also the matter of a little deal that had to be addressed.
That was an interesting time, even in our personal lives. So at that time, you were working at Raytheon, and they were having layoffs. And so the thought was, I remember one day you said, "I got to get to work because there are layoffs that are occurring, and I don't want to be late." And I said, "Okay, just go ahead, drive that day." So he went to work, and when he went to work, he called me and said, "Honey, I just got laid off." Because part of his concern was how was he going to pastor full-time and then work full-time. Mm-hmm. And so when he called and said he got laid off, I said, "Well, I guess God settled that part of it." And during that whole process, I kept saying, "Yes, he's going to be the pastor. He's going to be the pastor." And then one of the mothers in the church said to me one day, "I guess that makes you the pastor's wife." And that hit me, and I went, "Oh." Because when we started dating and we saw that this was going to be a thing, we had made a deal that he was not going to go into ministry, so I wouldn't have to be a pastor's wife. And we shook hands, remember? We mm-hmm. shook hands. And so all of that deal that we made came front and center. And so I had to have a conversation with God and say, "God, I did not want to be a pastor's wife." And so I went a little bit kicking and screaming as far as my side of it, but I did go supporting him because I saw, again, what Mom Ward, the type of support she had been for Pops, and I wanted to be that for him and more.
Ooh. Ooh.
your back on me, letting me go through all this pain and suffering at the hour of midnight. There's no sign of you, morning or daylight.
I found the transition, at first it was difficult when I was kicking and screaming, but when I finally said, okay, God, not my will, I had to have my Garden of Gethsemane moment. Mm-hmm. And it was a couple of mothers, and actually it was Mom Ward as well, that said, if God has called you, then he's called you. Then it was like, okay, Lord, let's go for the ride. I'm going to go where you take me. I say yes to your will. And a yes had to be a real yes, not a conditional yes. Mm-hmm. And so once I said yes, I was good. And then it's like, all right, I gave the world and everything else 100%. I got to give God 150%.
Yeah. It was kind of surreal. Mm-hmm. Because you then feel the weight of the responsibility. Mm-hmm. And the responsibility is a lot bigger than certainly you would ever imagine from coming from a position of being an associate pastor on staff. Mm-hmm. And now you're thinking about the whole process of what it takes to do ministry. Mm-hmm. So before, I didn't have to really think about the vision so much because I'm following the visionary. I'm mm-hmm. serving the visionary. I pretty much had to, you know, kind of think about my area and holding down my area. But once you become senior pastor, you now have to have the oversight and responsibility from budgets to, oh yeah, I gotta hire somebody. First thing, it's like, okay, how do you go through the whole process of dealing with all the requirements and your 501c3 and, you know, so all of those things I had to think through, not only for the where we were, but then the preaching on top of that and how would the worship work and those things were, yeah, the weight of it.
And in true apostolic Pentecostal church fashion, the weight would be supported by the faithful. As the vision began to come into focus, there was no mistaking that the church at 47 Howard Street would not only remain, but increase its reach as the lifeblood of the neighborhood with a renewed commitment to spiritual growth, coupled with a heart to serve and enrich the soul of the community.
The basic foundations of not just the denomination, but the Word of God coming forth. It's biblically based, and that is a part of the foundation of the denomination, that the Word is the truth. It is without error. You know, it was written by men who were inspired by God. The Word is God breathed. That's the Word. That is what was coming from Pastor Ward's mouth.
This is where I grew up going to church. This is where I learned what it meant to have a relationship with God. This is where I learned what faith means. This is where I learned how to rely on that faith every single day in dealing with life and life's obstacles. And so for me, it is the foundation of my faith.
When I came out to Boston for college, I was looking for a way to grow and just to understand God in a new way. And I really felt like the first year that I was here, every sermon, pastor was saying something that was really impactful and was really going to change my life. I'd led Bible studies in the past. I led a Bible study at my home church. I led another Bible study at Harvard. And in those experiences, I always felt like I wasn't really prepared to lead people spiritually. But I actually took the class 101 and under Reverend Prescott. And she was just incredible. You know, things that I'd read multiple times that I thought I understand this, you know, I could see how it would apply to my life in a new way. And, you know, I think that it was through that experience and actually through her encouraging me to go on to become a teacher, and Sister Brown, who, you know, really believed in me and said, you know, you are the sort of person that can help people, can new believers lead, you know, Christian lives. And it was really great to have older saints who were there encouraging me.
My background is in theology. So I've studied a lot of theology. I love engaging intellectually and asking questions and, you know, really diving in at a deep level. And Pastor, he preaches from the Word. You know, he gives you good meat to think about and to chew on. But there are all kinds of churches where, you know, they're talking on high levels about theology in which I could engage at that level. And I would enjoy engaging at that level. And I would get a lot out of that. But the way that we encounter God on Sunday mornings at Abundant Life, that's transformative. That's what changes hearts and minds and what makes a difference. And then when you wed that with pastors saying, go and live it out, that's how you change communities.
In the history of Christianity, it's really the Black church that has done the best job of being a community center to provide for people's needs. And a lot of that is because of a sad story of excluding African-American Black people from centers of power. So the Black church became the kind of power center for a whole range of community things, including helping people who needed food help or people who needed job help and that sort of thing. You know, Jesus said, on this rock I will build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. And he didn't say, on this rock I'll build a seminary. So, you know, the church is really the focal point.
Well, they build their houses in preparation for the king, and they line the sidewalks with every sort of shiny thing. They will be surprised when they hear him say, take me to the alley.
I've been feeling like there's been such a tremendous growth, but even just pushing me, I know Rev is always saying she's stretching people, and even when I didn't feel like I was ready, you know, she was able to see that readiness in me and just kind of push me. And with God's grace, it's been beautiful serving.
Abundant Life impacted me a lot because being a person that didn't know God way back when, coming here on an invite from a member made me choose the right way instead of the wrong way. So between listening to pastor's sermons, being involved in ministry, I was able to let go of what was hindering me. Being here, I was able to be a mother in the right way and not the wrong way. Being a leader in ministry, being an employee at my job, better. Having an insight what God has done for me in my heart and in my life changed me. And that's what Abundant Life has done, changed me a lot.
They challenge you from the first day you walk through the door, man. When I first came here, Dr. Prescott was one of the associate pastors, and like she was on me from day one, right? She used to always kind of like give you these little prophecies, like, girl, God got something for you, and that'd make you run even further away. But you know, they really, it's not a church where you can just be stagnant. It's a church where they want you to know who you are in Christ and to develop so that you can go out and, you know, help other people and bring other people in. So Bishop has definitely challenged us into callings, into places we don't think we'd probably have gone, right? Yeah. And word to the wise, don't ever tell Bishop or Rev the things that God is calling you to, because they will hold you to it and they will push you into those places.
And many of those places are outside the walls of the physical church. The leadership has released and encouraged members to develop their gifts of service wherever they see a need.
Well, I think it should be a community church that is supportive of the people. And that's not just the people that come in the doors, but people in the community as well.
Only ones that somehow lost.
About 20 years ago, I received a phone call from a Dr. Prescott, and she introduced herself. She said, "Hello, I'm Dr. Prescott, and my church would like to come and serve at the Salvation Army on Christmas Day." I thought, that's a little strange, you know. And so I said, "Yeah, I guess." She said, "We'll cook, we'll do all the cleaning, we'll do all the serving." And she said she'd call me back about the menu. So I said, "Yeah, fine." And then she called me back about the menu. We discussed the menu. And then it started since then. I remember I didn't meet her till Christmas Day, because I wasn't going to let somebody come into my house and just start serving and leave. So I met her at Christmas Day. She was coming at 8:30 in the morning, and I came at 8:30, and she was already here.
Take me.
This is where it all happens. This is the very first time I laid my eyes on Dr. Prescott. She was like this, based in a turkey. With her apron, looking up here, talking to somebody. It happens weeks before, not Christmas Day. They come in weeks before, they decorate the tree, they decorate the ceilings. It's not like they come in that morning. They're very, with the ladders, getting the guys in the program to help them hang things. And so she's very particular about it. I get here about 7:30, 7 o'clock. I'm not here. They're here before me, and food's cooking and smelling's going on, and they get all these tables set up here, and they're cutting pies and stuff. And in the other room was where they were getting the shoes ready, the packages ready, the gifts ready. One Christmas, we had a woman that was abused here. She said to me, "I'm going to take her to Boston Medical." She goes, "I know some people there." I mean, it was Christmas Day. She was here early in the morning, cooking all day. And she brought the woman that was abused over to Boston Medical. It means to me that it's not only the Salvation Army. It's a sister, brother in Christ serving the people. The vulnerable people, to be able to reach out to the people, to give an encouraging word when they were talking to them, smiling at them, it was smiling with them, having conversation with them. It's just a partnership. We're not one. We're all in this for Christ, for the kingdom. And I always think, oh, the king would be so happy seeing all this.
Take me to the alley. Take me to the afflicted ones. Take me to the lonely ones that somehow lost their way. Let them hear me say, I am your friend. Come to my table. Rest here in my garden. You will have a pardon.
And those acts of service also include a holistic approach of combining spiritual-based solutions to secular challenges.
Does anyone have any strategies they use while, you know, so if you're being stopped or you're encountering an officer and there's, you know, clearly it's racially, you know, you were driving while black?
For me, it's like my mom always said, you know, it takes two to argue. So one of the things that you were like, when it comes to police officers with me, when they at that level, then I'll bring my level down. And I think that either makes him even more upset, but he really can't do nothing because you're just like, yes, sir. And you're really polite to them. And some of them can't take that. You know, when you just give them that respect that they want, you let them feel like they're the authority figure. And that, you know, at the same time, you're walking away alive.
It's always been a struggle with me to one, maintain my dignity, but at the same time, you know, not back down, you know what I'm saying, when racism, you know what I'm saying, raises its ugly head, is to address it. And to address it forcefully, because I know what it's designed to do. It's designed to make you to make you subdued or subtle or turn away. You know, and I'm not saying you can be firm when you address it, but respectful at the same time.
I just go back to how my mother used to say, just be respectful. When you leave the house, be respectable because you're representing your family. You come across any altercation, handle it professionally, not aggressively, and talk it out. If you can't talk it out, just don't be bothered with the person, because all you're going to do is create tension, and that's going to escalate over into a bigger thing than what it is.
So I guess as I'm hearing all of this, how do we wrestle with this as men of faith? You're a man of faith. You know all that Jesus has done for you. You filled with the Holy Spirit. How do you now step outside and interact with this racially charged world that's happening right now? How do you still carry your faith through this?
We have a judge that's going to be the ultimate judge. So when you're dealing with these situations, I really don't let it bother me that much, to be quite honest with you. Years ago, it bothered me, but now it's kind of like, you know, whatever. And I even informed the police officer. I said, I know you have a tough job right now, and I appreciate your service. And that changed the whole atmosphere when it was over. I waited till, you know, he let me go and he passed, and then I informed him of that fact. I said, you know, I appreciate your service and things of that nature. And that now that gave him something to think about, because I know that sparked something in it, because, you know, he shook my hand three times. So I know that actually might change a situation where how he deals with another young black man. Or I'll consider myself young today for this, but another man of color. So, right, that's what, however I perceive myself to be. But, you know, hopefully that'll change the way he deals with somebody.
Perhaps we can also connect with the other Cambridge churches that are doing this, and Bishop-elect can help facilitate something like that, because there are good thoughts coming all around. And maybe if we come together and we come in with a shared force and a shared identity, that would help us.
Well, I think it's, like, very upsetting, the things that's going on, and, like, the people, like, in the world today, how, like, they're, like, doing crazy things, like killing police officers, is really upsetting.
I would say God has helped me deal with my feelings by giving me a reason to the madness, to, you know, give me something to believe in, that there isn't just all crazy and all bad and all danger in the world, that I can have hope, that there is grace, that there is mercy, that there is love in the world.
I just want to know, will you sit with me? As I grieve, can you grieve with me? And I think it can be really quick to jump to, where's the solution, where's the solution? Let's talk, let's talk, let's talk. And we live in an uncertain world, and we don't have the answers. And that's why I think people are so frustrated. We don't have the answers. And so for me, the question is, can you just sit with me? Can you just hold me? Can you just be there? So that then, once we've grieved, once we've had space to just sit, we can then move forward in a way that's strategic, in a way that's rooted in love and not fear, not anger, but in a way that can really be sustainable and can lead to the brotherhood, the sisterhood, the unity that I think God calls for our world to be. Because right now, I think we're just in that reactionary space. And I just kind of want to pause. And so will you pause with me? I think the church has a great opportunity here to both be a voice and to be publicly speaking and engaged in the conversation, and at the same time to say, wait a minute, but be still and know that I am God. Be still and know that I am. Be still and know. Be still. Be.
While an emphasis on service will be seen by some as a shift or change in mission, change signals growth, a growth that would soon challenge the church to further stretch itself.
Most times in changes that I sense that God has led me on came through a prayer. Mm-hmm. And as I started to think about where the direction of the church would go, and it didn't come out of just changing the name for changing namesake. It came from an understanding that as a leader, my responsibility is to define reality, but also understand where the church is going and where God wants to take the church. Where is God working and how to work with them? Mm-hmm. And once I started to do some praying about it, I started to read different scriptures and passages of scriptures where names mean something. Names have always meant something. So when you're reading a name in the Bible and you see that name being changed, it has to deal with the character of the person or the character of a place or a significant happening in a certain place. And then I started to think about what is the thing that God is trying to do in this place. Mm-hmm. And the name Abundant Life came up because I was reading the passage in John chapter 10, verse 10, where he says, the thief cometh not but to steal and to kill and destroy, but I have come that you might have life and to have it more abundantly. Mm-hmm. We are to be a life-giving ministry. Mm-hmm. That was a game changer. Mm-hmm. How do we give life to people? Mm-hmm. Well, the gospel gives life to people. Mm-hmm. How do we help people with their connection with faith and life connecting? Mm-hmm. And so as we start to really pray about these things, and I said, well, Apostolic Pentecostal Church is a name, and some people would call it defining by the founder's name, but it seemed as though God was really saying that this is kind of a new thing that he's doing, and I think that names really identify what something really is and what something is really for and what's to do. And so that was my purpose for to change.
Apostolic Pentecostal to Abundant Life Church, you know, and it was a big change. And some of the older saints really did not like it. They resented it. We ended up having some people, they left the church. But, you know, it was a name change, and I think that was for the Pastor Larry, you know, had good reason to change it. So I think it's fine.
There are patterns and there are principles that have to be adhered to in order for this legacy to continue. And I would say that they are continuing because you're not afraid of change and you're not afraid of, you know, moving out of the comfort zone of what we knew as Howard Street, Dotton's church, which it isn't. It is the Lord's church, right? And all of that, but moving away from that and really taking on the identity of who God meant for this church to be, I think that is a legacy. I think that is a testimony.
Standing on the promise of Isaiah 43 and 19, Abundant Life Church positioned itself for the new thing that God was doing in their midst. The transformation touched every aspect of the worship experience, from the inclusion of liturgical arts presentations to the music ministry. Thank you.
had to shift the culture. We brought in drums, and we didn't have drums here before. It was primarily Mum Ward on the organ. But then Mum Ward, she made room, and she said, I'm going to help and train up other younger musicians. And so she helped to train up and support other younger musicians. So then we actually had a worship team and a band, and we started rehearsing. And we didn't totally throw away the hymns, so we would alternate the hymns with praise choruses. We made up a praise chorus book. And so the music, the sound began to evolve while the look was evolving. But we made sure that we were true to the Word of God. We made sure that we weren't doing it just to be contemporary or doing it just for culture's sake. But we wanted to make sure that the sound of the church was growing and developing as the new name came about.
My expression and my viewpoint of music is that it all comes from God. And I had often heard the older musicians talk about that. They would say, you know, jazz comes directly from God through the, you know, from the creator through the improviser to the audience. That was part of Art Blakey's speech. Mm-hmm. And I believe that really to be true before I came to church. I was, you can't have music, such a tremendous expressive art form, and not have that come from God. And so it was just that feeling that I could have input and that I could be have an impact in the church by bringing music, my musical talents. So we started with the music program, trying to get young students involved in learning about music.
We started doing things like Heaven or Hell and being very creative with the space and being very creative with the gifts and the talents, using all of media and also, but using all of the arts to express the bigness of who God is. Oh, you are a sure foundation. You are a sure foundation. Oh, everlasting King. Through the winds and the stormy weather, you guide us on your wing. Lord of all ages, we come. Come, oh, quiet and still. Yeah. Waiting to hear how you will lead us. Ready to do we your will. You are a rock. Lord, strong and mighty.
Now we have a jazz series, and it takes place at Abundant Life Church. And my feeling is it's a good thing to connect the music with the church. Our goal is to cultivate the relationship in such ways that when you're talking about the Cambridge Jazz Festival, that it becomes synonymous with Abundant Life Church. Oh, if you want to hear good music, oh, wait till the Jazz Festival series starts. We're going to be doing like 6-7 concerts in between the Jazz Festival at Abundant Life Church. And it's just a wonderful feeling to know that we have that relationship and that it will hopefully grow and continue.
One Sunday we were here and Mark was playing drums. He was the drummer for the church. He was 6 years old and he was scuffling, as you can imagine. He was self-taught 6 year old trying to play drums with the worship team. And so that evening I was talking about it at home with my wife and I was like, you know, I think he has some talent and he could probably do well if he had some lessons. You know, they need to get him some lessons. And she said, well, you're Mr. Hot Shot jazz musician, travel around the world. You give him lessons. And so that was the beginning of the music program. It actually started with Mark, and the point was to at first just get him started, and then he was so talented and became serious about it. Then it became a matter of we want to get him in the music school, and then at some point we're like, we're just going to go the whole way. We want him to go to music school, we want a full ride, and we want him to have a successful career in music. So he's taken all those steps. He worked hard over the years. He he got a full scholarship to Berkeley, graduated in 3 years, Dean's List, and now he's out playing, doing his thing.
In keeping with the biblical principles of sowing and reaping, the shift from Apostolic Pentecostal to Abundant Life not only yielded a crop of new believers, but a renewed commitment to becoming a house of prayer.
It's like breathing. You can't live unless you breathe. So that's how prayer is to me. So I gravitate towards that as well. And, you know, Abundant Life, when I first came, that's the thing that drew me in to say, okay, I will come back and be a part of the organization again, because I not only saw the bishop talk about prayer as it announced, but coming there and seeing him there, not once or twice, but consistently being there. It's like you're not just saying the word, but you're actually doing the word. And that's pretty hard to find a lot of the times.
Yeah, I work in the school system, and days are hard, but that the prayer life that is cultivated in me, and I've been able to take that in my workplace, I think, and even being able to interact with some of my coworkers who are, I know, are non-believers, and that prayer life, I think, is impacting my work life and those relationships.
The prayer team, corporate prayer, morning prayer, that's like, I'm excited about just the opportunity to fellowship in prayer in on Saturday mornings, and even throughout the week, the morning prayers, that's just awesome. And that is what keeps me coming back. I love to pray, and this is a house of prayer. And I'm excited. That's just amazing. That's my favorite thing about ALC, the praying team and the leadership, and just how we make praying a priority.
In the prayer life, one of the things that it helps me outside of the church is just the prayer life. Like Victoria said, it helps in our own personal lives, and also in witnessing it on your job and being confident and bold in speaking, but not being too radical in it and just saying and living it out. And so they preach a lot and support a lot on how to live out the word as opposed to just being a talker. So my prayer life, and definitely how to live out and walk the way God wants us to walk outside of a church, outside of the four walls.
So I had come out here for my internship with Gordon College, and then I had come back actually, and I had a decision whether or not to come back to Abundant Life, come back to Boston. I felt like the Lord was calling me towards seminary. But as I started dating this handsome man over the summer, and as I was thinking about the fact that my family is in California, and I'd been serving at another church, a very multi-ethnic and thriving congregation, on what felt like a youth ministry dream team, and things were really starting to come into place in that youth ministry in terms of growth. I was like, Lord, I don't really want to leave California. But he had already placed Boston on my heart as a multicultural, multi-ethnic, almost a missionary field place for me to be and to live. And so I think I was just being a little restless with the decision. And I went to my church, and the sermon topic for that day, our pastor's like, today I'm going to talk to you on the topic of, I have abundant life. And I was like, okay, Lord. Okay, you don't have to be so literal with me. But
on paper, if you were to look at all the scenarios in which I was making the decision to move to Boston, everyone would say you should not move to Boston. And everyone did. And I remember sitting down and just like praying to God about like whether I should go out here, even though everything was saying that I shouldn't, like everything. And when I was praying, I just had peace. And one of the things I've learned about God is that he always puts me at a moment of peace whenever I'm doing what he wants me to be doing. And there was just so much peace and tranquility about the idea about me making this move that it was just like, okay, God, I'm not questioning you. I am going to keep moving forward because I know that where you are, there is peace, and I am trusting in that peace as I moved into Boston. And I can tell you that God has blessed me so much from what I've been able to learn from Pastor Larry, Bishop Larry now, being able to hear the word that he has, what God has spoken to him, the importance of having a powerful work ethic, the importance of developing yourself personally so that you can be able to impact not just your life, but the people around you. And that your faith, and I'm going to totally pull it out here, but taking your faith and your life and having them connect. Because you can't just have your faith here and then your life over here. You've got to put those together, because if you're just doing one or the other, and you do one once in a while and the other times, you're a fake. You're not real. People aren't going to relate to you. You're not going to be able to make a difference in either side of the scenario. It's only when you connect those two.
Abundant Life has really been transformative in my spiritual life, in my personal life, in my professional life. Spiritually, you know, I grew up as a Christian, but it was during my college years, and Abundant Life was a huge part of it, where I really learned to spend time with the Lord on a daily basis, to grow my prayer life. It was actually through Abundant Life where I was really introduced to the disciplines of fasting and prayer. Of course, you know, I prayed beforehand, but it wasn't something that my previous church experiences really emphasized or valued. And so being in Abundant Life, I learned how to pray. I learned how to seek God. I learned how to fast and to listen and to hear from Him in a new way. I learned how to develop my spiritual gifts.
What people don't understand, that prayer is very, very, very important. You will see a lot of people in rejoicing service, which is good, but put me in a prayer service. Prayer, reaching to God. You can break yokes. You can break chains, burdens, anything that lay on you shouldn't be lay on. You call upon God, and you believe in Him strong, and the power of God can set you free. It can set you free.
Mentoring the flock has always been an essential part of the spiritual walk. And at Abundant Life Church, the Reverend Dr. Virginia Ward, or Rev as she's affectionately called, has had quite an impact in that area.
My first Bible was given to me by Pastor Virginia. I still use it. I still apply it to my life. And in it, she talks about use this and read this word and you shall grow. And so I took her up on that and did it my own way for a lot of the time. But at the end of the day, they always instilled in us, Bishop and Pastor, to take the word. You don't have to take everyone's interpretation of it. Read it yourself. Listen to it. If you are listening to something that's spiritual or a musical selection, listen to it. Process it for yourself and use that to live your life fully. And they are very practical in their lessons. And so I've taken those and grown as a result.
Well, it started as a young girl just coming here and not really knowing who God was, who Jesus is. She kind of was like a spiritual mom to me. I didn't have it at home. Like, I had a relationship with my mom, but I didn't have the relationship that I had here with my mom, where I could speak to her about anything. She didn't judge me. She didn't make me feel guilty or, you know, bad about any decisions I made. She would just be like, talk to me, you know, let me know what's going on, you know, kind of like how you would talk to a friend. And so I think that's what kept me. And she's always been that way, even till this day. Like, I could call her up or send a text and be like, hey, can you pray for me? This is what I'm going through. Or, you know, send an idea or a thought, and she'd respond and just be genuine about it.
So I've known the Reverend Dr. Virginia Ward for nearly a decade. She came to work for DiVarsity through a mutual friendship we have with the Bishop Brian Green at Pentecostal Tabernacle. Brian had told me that we were looking for a new Black Campus Ministry director. I wanted to see the work expand. And he had told me that there was someone he wanted to put me in connection with, and that if she said yes, I would rise up and call him blessed forever.
She was always there, and she was very wise. So she was somebody I could always go to when things were difficult and when I was trying to make sense of things that were beyond me. She was present and approachable and easy to speak with. And she always had wisdom for me. Sometimes hard to accept, you know, hard words, but always wisdom, always giving me something to think about.
So I was going to, I think it was Boston College. I was going to Black Campus Ministries conference. I had just came to faith in 2009. And somebody told me about this conference for Black students. So I go there and I'm excited, like, all right, what's that going to be like? And then I remember her leading something and just opening up. And I was like, oh, this lady's kind of dynamic. I was like, I like it. She's real. Okay. She's making me laugh. And she's, you know, she's Black, but she's, you know, she's good. So that's the first time I met her. And I realized that she was a mother figure right away. And she was someone that was shepherding people.
I think I had never thought of myself as a woman of color or that it was important. I remember, though, one time in particular, it was like a few years into staff work, where Virginia was talking about how the BCM conference was possible because of the partners in the room. And she had made a point to say, especially the women of color, and she had a stand. And I was like, that's me. I had a moment where I was like, oh, she is identifying something in me that I had never seen before and that actually it was important and that it was a gift. So that was the first time I think I like registered being a female leader of color. But I remember at one point she looked at me and she was like, I see you. Like as a South Asian woman, I see you and that, you know, you need a voice too. And I was like, oh, I do, you're right. It's just such simple things she says, like, I see you, or you need a voice, like or you deserve a voice, too, that, like, it just changes the course of how you think of yourself and your leadership and what it means to follow after Jesus.
When Virginia stands up in front, she not only makes people sit up because she's funny, because she's energetic, because she's insightful, but she calls them to their better self, and she calls them to engage in a mission that she fully believes in. And they might not have been sure they believed it before she got started. By the end of the time she's speaking, they're on board. And because she speaks the truth in a way that can be heard, people who get on board with a mission, they come to a place where they become more themselves, they become better in themselves than they were before.
The Hebrew word, avodah, translates to mean a seamless life of work, worship, and service. The guiding principle that has driven the Good Shepherd at Abundant Life Church. And as the word teaches, he that is faithful in that which is least is faithful also in much. In that spirit, God's favor was about to bless Pastor Larry Ward in the form of an elevation.
The whole elevation to bishop. So, okay, I'm going to rewind. So we were in service and at the deacon's ordination, and mm-hmm. Pastor Chandler was here. And he looks over at him and says something about him being a bishop. Now, at first we were kind of like, okay. But what made that kind of like a, ooh, Mufasa God moment was we had gone out to dinner a couple of weeks ago with a young adult couple in our church. And so they asked him, so do you see your next level becoming a bishop since you're overseeing churches and you're working with other pastors and we're going to do a church plant? And he said, nah, I want to be a bishop. And I said, oh, no. We were like, oh, no. Because the weight of that. Mm-hmm. But it's one of those things that when I got my doctorate, I said, okay, Lord, you're lifting me. I don't see myself being lifted above him. Then you must have a lift in store for him.
What happened was that Pastor Chandler, as you know, he came to Abundant Life and prophesied that Pastor Larry was to be a bishop. Now, I wasn't there, but he told me about it. And he told me that Pastor Larry confirmed that within a span of about 2 weeks, Pastor Chandler was like the third person who kind of said, hey, are you a bishop or you should be a bishop? So so that being said, I really felt in my heart that that was a word from the Lord. So what happened was that we were having a meeting with the district pastors, Pastor Lorraine Thornhill, Pastor Warren Collins, Pastor Clayton Ward, and Pastor Larry Ward was supposed to be there. Well, apparently his dad, Pastor Aiden, got sick and he had to rush him to the hospital. So he said, well, go on with the meeting without me. So as the meeting commenced, I shared with the pastors, hey, you know, Pastor Larry got the prophetic word from Pastor Chandler, explained this the whole thing. And I said, you know what? I think we need to do this. I think this is what the Lord is saying, and we need to do this. So I said, what do you guys say? And everybody said, yeah, we vote on it. So I text Pastor Ward, and I said, we just voted to make you bishop. And, of course, he texts back, like, what happened? Where did this come from? Like, I leave you all just to have a meeting because I'm taking care of my dad. And the next thing you know, you're making me bishop?
When I heard that this bishop was going to take place for Bishop Larry, I was like, wow, okay, she's going to be stepping into the same role that I had already been in for 10 years. I just immediately decided, like, praying for her. Mm-hmm. You know, I was like, wow, this is a big step. Right. But I knew that she was capable of being in, you know, in this position or being elevated in the position because of just her background. You know, she's just really gifted, a gifted teacher, gifted speaker. And I just knew that she would be, you know, fine with this. She would be okay with it.
And no, the other thing I think also is the fact, and this is something that I wanted to go back to as far as saying to him why I thought he needed to expedite the process of becoming a bishop, because I think that also it was a reward to his dad's faithfulness. Mm. And for his dad to be able to see his son be elevated to bishop.
I think that the role of being bishop is certainly a honorable one, but it does have a lot of responsibility to it, to be like a father to the church. And it's kind of funny and strange that, you know, bishop is really kind of stepping into a fathering role. Mm-hmm. And as I watch my dad and as he's gracefully aging and how he fathered spiritual kids and as his natural kids, there's much a much bigger mandate now to sow into the life of others and to see them grow and to inspire them. And I think a bishop is a role of being a father and helping folks who are younger, who are inexperienced, to find their way and hopefully turn back and do something in the lives of others who are coming along behind them.
Lift up mine eyes to the hills, from whence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord who made heaven and earth. He said, He will not suffer your foot to be moved. He's the Lord that keepeth thee, and he will not slumber nor sleep. For the Lord is thy keeper, the Lord is thy shade. Upon thy right hand, upon thy right hand. And oh, the sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. for he shall preserve your soul even forevermore. 'Cause my hand, oh, my help, my help, all of my help cometh from the Lord.
Yeah, it was kind of overwhelming.
Yeah.
It was overwhelming. I didn't really hit a 3-minute ovation, to be honest with you. I was just trying to say, Lord, let me get down the aisle so I won't trip or something. And it's like, okay, let me, you know, it was kind of just surreal. I just feel that, you know, that sense of responsibility. Mm-hmm. I'm grateful, but it keeps me on my knees, definitely, to pray and to really support the churches and the pastors that, you know, I've been supporting, but in a much more intentional way.
So for him to be elevated to the office of a bishop, that said to me that there was still more to do and there was still a call on him. So I was just proud watching him literally stretch into it. So I almost felt like he was getting to a space of, okay, the church, I'm doing good, community, and doing the avodah, the faith and work. But there was more stretching and more growing. So the role of the bishop gave him more room to stretch into. So on that day, seeing him in his priestly garments and seeing him just step into that space, I was like, wow. It was just awesome to see him embrace it, but also to see that role envelop him and to stretch him to a new space. So yes, I was proud mummy, proud wifey that day.
As Abundant Life Church moves through the century mark, it calls to mind one of the old hymns, "I Don't Feel No Ways Tired," where the song poet says, "I've come too far from where I started. Nobody told me that the road would be easy. I don't believe he brought me this far to leave me." The message is clear, and the legacy is lasting.
I definitely think for the ministry, one, that it grows, but people also grow, and that they grow in their spiritual walk, and that they're passing it on. So they're helping someone else who's broken, who needs help, that they're mentoring them, they're teaching them through the Word of God. And that ultimately, when folks hear the name Abundant Life, that it brings a smile to their face, and that they can say, that's the place where I experienced the love of God. That's the place where I learned the Word. That's the place that I learned how to pray, that it's just an awesome ministry to be a part of, not the size of the building or the amount of members, but just that the Holy Spirit is here.
This is a global church, and we affect our global neighbors because we're sending great people. We're sending God-filled people, Holy Spirit-filled people into the nations. So I see this place continuing to do what they already do, and that's affect the earth, affect the kingdom of God globally.
We're in 100 years, and I think we're doing well going into the 100 years. I'm only praying to the Lord that I will be alive to see the 100 years and see what the future is going to be like with the younger generation.
Well, for Abundant Life Church to make 100, it's significant because that means there's a strong legacy and a strong foundation that was laid at this church. And so that says something, that it's still going strong in the community. And so I think it's wonderful. I think it's something to celebrate, because when you look in the Bible for 100 years, And to know that people made 100, it was a milestone. It was like, you know, it's like you reach some place where you're about to birth something even new.
A lot of people who come to Abundant Life are looking for family. They're looking to be restored and to be connected to a body of believers who will love on them and connect with them and help to stretch them and to grow. And as they grow and they're elevated, their whole family is, and hopefully their communities are as well. And then they move on and then another batch comes in. And that's something that even with the 100th, that we're hoping that as we go through the 100 voices of faith and the 100 years, there are so many voices of people. So although it may not be a mega building, but we're a mega ministry of hearts as we can connect and count all the people that have come through and how they've touched and who they've touched as well.
My vision going forward is that we're now coming into a place where we're actually looking at how effective are we in making disciples? How effective are we in building a people who really are committed to Christ, are able to appropriate His message into their lives and be able to share that with other people. And so that changes the whole scope of it now. It's an empowering ministry versus just a gathering place where we, you know, get comfort, healing, or marriages and celebration of life. But it comes in an equipping center. And that's, I think that's kind of what I envision. That's kind of what I really would like to see in these next several years beyond 100 years.
History that I'm telling you we're taking to heaven. It's that deep, it's that rich, it's that strong. They don't